rose-colored glasses are off, it's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo A Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 5 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. So, no interview this week, just me. Before we continued with any more interviews, I wanted to take a step back and really delve into the difference between free and at no cost and how to actually work for free without putting yourself in a bind financially, because that really does inform a lot of the questions I ask in the interviews and how I structure them. Because something you're going to encounter as a digital marketing consultant is that people are going to expect you to work for free. And just generally speaking, the internet as a whole, people expect things to be free online. So things that traditionally cost money offline, like, you know, music, videos, that type of thing, if it's online, people don't expect to pay for them. So you really need to know how to navigate those quote unquote free waters without putting yourself in a bind financially or straining any of your professional relationships, which unfortunately I have done both of. So again, just taking a step back, the purpose for this podcast in general as a whole is I'm talking to myself 10 years ago. So I'm talking to my younger self when I'm 22 years old, a young professional just starting out, because, you know, I'm that age, man. I'm 32 years old. I don't have any 20s left. And, you know, I can say that in terms of career trajectory, I wasted my 20s. I spent a lot of time just trying to figure things out on Google. I waited a very long time before I made a professional investment in myself. And that time could have been better spent. Because if you look at a lot of the top digital marketers today, some of them are my contemporaries. So if you look at somebody like a Mike King from iPoolRank.com or Brian Fanzo or Carlos Gill, I'm roughly the same age as these people. However, they made certain choices in their 20s that set them up for the careers that they have in their 30s that I didn't make. Take, for example, Mike King of iPoolRank.com, he knows how to code. So he was able to take his coding abilities and parlay that into technical SEO, which he then parlayed into professional speaking, and then, you know, having his own shop at iPoolRank.com. And I don't know how to code. Like, I know enough to pass the class. Like, if somebody pulled a gun out and was like, you know, hyperlink this text, I could make it work. But I don't have that hard skill that he does that allowed him to, you know, set himself up in that manner. That's actually the second question I ask people in the interviews, is if you could go back in time without causing any paradoxes or damaging the space-time continuum, what would you teach your younger self? Yes, we are Doctor Who fans in this house. Whovians in this beat. No, I'm just playing. But yeah, like that, like that's the overall reason for the podcast as a whole. And then the last question that I ask is a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked in his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast. And yes, fellow members of Fire Nation, I did ask permission before I modified that question. And I change it as follows. Imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experiences, knowledge, and skills you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, baby. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, internet, Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free? So, why do I ask that question? Why do I structure it the way that I do? Well, there's the stated reason that I give in the interviews, which I'll cover here in a little bit. But then there's the real reason that I ask that question. And that's because I had an unfortunate experience with this person I met via networking. She was the head of CEO space here in Atlanta. And CEO space is kind of this for lack of a better term, like behind the scenes incubators for products and services and just professional development in general. So a lot of the top personal development speakers like a Les Brown or a Lisa Nichols, they went through CEO space. The product Airborne, those effervescent tablets that you drop in water to boost your immune system, that came out of CEO space. And so it just has a lot of connections that can really help you get where you want to be professionally. And so this person, through her involvement with CEO space, she had her own personal clients, and one of them, who shall remain nameless, she charges like $15,000 for a strategy. However, she doesn't know how to fulfill. And so this person in CEO space was trying to get myself and our company, Digital Marketing Advisors, to do the fulfillment for her client. And so on the fulfillment side, it's kind of easy to get pimped because in the digital marketing space, fulfillment has, to a very large extent, been commoditized because, you know, you have virtual assistants that you can get in the Philippines or in India that charge a fraction of what someone like myself would charge. So you got to kind of be careful when dealing with people because they might be wanting to charge those, you know, Upwork prices, and here you are in the US and you're substantially more. However, the flip side to this coin is that because you're here stateside and they can actually get a hold of you, you know, you might be able to go a little bit more on the quality side, which is where I find a lot of success because I have a degree specific to internet marketing and I can show a little bit more value than somebody in, say, the Philippines. Anyway, in addition to just, you know, getting beat up on price, this person had an unfortunate experience with prior service providers, which is not uncommon because I listened to the Social Pros podcast by Jay Baer, and the very first episode in 2016, he had people from the Agency Management Institute on there. They had just released their 2015 hiring and firing report, and the podcast was on why agencies get fired so often. And they surveyed companies with budgets between a $500,000 and $4 million. So these are substantial budgets, right? And a full 36% of folks said that the people who sold them these digital marketing services, you know, they didn't get what they paid for. So, you know, the unfortunate reality is that in the professional digital marketing space, a lot of people were faking the funk for a long time. So you have people out here who have been jaded, and so they really require a lot of nurturing up front before they're willing to do business with you. However, the flip side to that coin is that on our side, as an agency owner and service provider, we have hard costs associated with running campaigns. It's not simply our labor. We use a tool called Reach Rocket, which is by Marty Weintraub from AimClear out of Minneapolis, and a few other pro-level tools so that we can produce those superior results. And those tools cost money. And so we were kind of at an impasse where this person basically wanted us to build the campaign, do all the work up front, and then she wanted to review it, and then only then would she pay. And we're like, look, that's not how we do things. We have hard costs on our end which need to be covered. So I'm happy not to charge you any hours because our agency, we charge $250 an hour, but you are going to have to cover the cost. And so that conversation was not handled appropriately, and unfortunately we did lose that deal. And that, I wouldn't go as far as to say the bridge had been burned with the lady at CEO space, but that relationship did suffer. So that's the real reason I asked the last question the way I asked it, because knowing how to work for free without bending yourself over a barrel is something that you're going to have to figure out, and it's a skill that you need. And then you have the stated reason that I asked the question, which is just as valid, and that is, in my professional opinion, there is a huge gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I'm referring to someone who works in-house at a corporation or brand or works at an agency. I am not referring to digital entrepreneurship, solopreneurs, somebody like a JLD or a Pat Flynn, even though, yes, you could absolutely make the case that they're professionals because they operate at such a high level. That isn't who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, people who get a W-2 at the end of the year, right? And so just using my own experience, my own journey as an analog, what ends up happening for folks is that they meander the wilds of Google for a year or 10. They have some wins, they have some losses. They learn some stuff, get introduced to Warrior Forum, network marketing, that sort of thing. And at some point after a year or 10, they decide to get serious. And then after they decide to get serious, they kind of have two options at that point. The first is they can do what I did, which is go back to school and get a degree in internet marketing. However, even though there's a lot of pros to that approach, the cons are it takes a long time. Even though the degree program is accelerated, it still takes 30 months to complete, and it's also very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 to get my degree. So I'm a distinct minority in the sense that my degree is specific to internet marketing. It's not like a journalism degree or run-of-the-mill MBA with a concentration in digital media. No, the whole thing, front to back, internet marketing. And that is a fraction of how the industry educates itself. The main way that the professional digital marketing space educates itself and disseminates best-in-class practices is through conferences and seminars. The problem with that is that even though in aggregate it's less expensive and quicker than getting a degree, you have to have that money up front. So most of your top tier conferences like a South by Southwest or a Marketing Profs B2B Forum or MozCon or Inbound Summit, something like that, the tickets are going to range anywhere from $500 to $1,500. That does not include your flight, your hotel, food, Uber back and forth. No, just to have your face in that place between $500 and $1,500, once you add all those things back in, you're easily looking for between $3,000 and $5,000 to spend on a single conference. And oftentimes what happens is that they have some type of VIP coaching program or some educational training program that they can upsell you to once you're there. And those range between $10,000 and $15,000 in my experience. So the entire funnel from actually attending the conference to purchasing the education program is right around $20,000. And yes, that's a full third of the $60,000 you would need to get a degree from Full Sail. However, you have to have that money up front. So what ends up happening, if you look at these conferences in terms of demographic breakdown, they tend to be like 90-95% white. Because if you look at wealth distribution, that's who has the disposable income to be able to drop $3,000 to $5,000 on a conference and then an additional $15,000 on the continuing education upsell, right? Makes a lot of sense. I mean, if I worked at a conference and my responsibility was to put butts in seats, I would target that demographic as well. However, if you're somebody like me, and you don't fit that demographic, you're kind of left with either figuring it out on Google, which again, there's absolutely no guarantees on that, or getting a degree and having to, you know, sell your firstborn child and prick your finger and sign in blood. And so I'm trying to figure out a better way, a better option in terms of career trajectory to where you can educate yourself at a professional level, but you're not stuck with rolling the dice on Google, buying these conferences, or getting a degree. So there you have it. You have the stated reason as to why I asked the last question, as well as the real reason that I asked the last question, because something that gets a lot of, you know, press and a lot of coverage is that there are options to getting a degree. There are options in professional education, but what doesn't get talked about as much is the importance of in the importance of access to capital, because there's a saying in the church that faith without works is dead. Well, I would say that opportunity without access is meaningless. Take somebody I admire like a John Lee Dumas. He talks about one of his mentors that he invested in, Jamie Tardy. He was paying this woman $2,000 a month. There is absolutely no way in hell I'd have been able to swing that. And it doesn't have anything to do with me not being willing to invest in myself. You don't borrow $57,000 from the U.S. Department of Education not being willing to invest in yourself. It doesn't have anything to do with not being coachable, because I actually completed my assignments. You got a lot of folks who went to college and flunked out because they was too busy partying. So I meet all of these other criteria, except the fact that, you know, I just could not access that capital. And, you know, that was a great source of turmoil for me. And I used to beat myself up a lot, because it's like, you know, why don't you want it bad enough? Why can't you figure it out? You know, this person just hopped online and made it. That person just hopped online and made it. What the hell is wrong with you? And something that needs to be discussed is that, you know, there is a gap there that professional high quality education, be it on Google or through a university, costs money, and you need to be able to access this capital. While we're on the subject of John Lee Dumas, if you take his free podcast course.com, which is awesome and amazing, by the way, highly recommend it if you're interested in podcasting at all. One of the things he talks about is you need to know your avatar. And my avatar for this podcast, his name is Lamar. He's 24 years old, going on 25. He did not go to college after graduating high school at age 18 because, unfortunately, he drank the Kool-Aid. You can just, you know, figure it out on Google and you don't need to go to college, right? This whole un-college movement. And so he spent the next 6 years having a series of wins and losses, mostly losses, you know, tried his hand at network marketing, tried his hand at Warrior Forum. So here he is, 24, 25 years, about to turn 25 years old. He has a 2-year-old daughter that he's struggling to support, and he stays up at night berating himself because he cannot provide the level of life that he feels his daughter deserves or that he knows he's capable of. So he's at that age where, had he just gone to school at age 18, he would have graduated by now. A lot of his friends have master's degrees and he have you know, an income that is commensurate with that. So he's at that stage where he's ready to make the investment. He's ready to go pro. However, he cannot afford going to conferences, and $60,000 is a lot of money for him, and he doesn't necessarily have the credit score to even be able to qualify for financial aid. He tried, and he has to come up with like $5,000 because he couldn't get a cosigner. So that's Lamar. That's my avatar. That's who I'm trying to reach with this podcast. So we're going to take a short break. I know I've rambled for quite a bit of time, and then I'm actually going to get into specific the difference between free and at no cost, and how to actually work for free without putting yourself in a bad position financially. Be right back. In the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news outperformed real news on Facebook. Now, don't worry, this is a podcast about marketing, not politics. But what I'm trying to pull out with that example is that most people can't call BS online when they see it. Now, this is in stark contrast to the whole un-college movement that favors finding information online, oftentimes for free, as opposed to paying for higher education. Now, that tactic can work, assuming you can call BS when you see it, which unfortunately most people just can't. The ability to call BS online, what we call digital discernment, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as the skill I learned getting a degree in digital marketing, for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now. That's bit.ly/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. Okay, welcome back. So online, there is this culture that things should be free, which can put you in a little bit of a bind because the things that people want for free actually cost money for you to produce. Take what I'm doing right now, this very instant, this podcast that you're listening to that did not cost you anything to download. I actually have a little bit of a cost involved in producing it. So first things first, you need equipment. I happen to use a MacBook Pro with a Logitech Clear Voice plugged directly into a USB port, and I record with GarageBand. So the cost of that, because I got my laptop through Full Sail University Financial Aid, they have what they call Launchbox, where you get your laptop, the entire Adobe Creative Suite 6, as well as the Logitech headset. The cost of Launchbox was like $4,200, because the MacBook Pro was $3,500, and then Creative Suite 6, like I said, the whole kit and caboodle. So I have, you know, Illustrator, Premiere Pro, Photoshop, Dreamweaver, everything. That costs like $700. And so you can certainly make out cheaper than that. That's just, you know, because of my journey and how I ended up where I am, that's what I use. Check out John Lee Dumas's freepodcastcourse.com. I don't have an affiliate link. That's completely free. He's blessed me with so much free content. I have no problem just giving him a shot. Go get that. I've taken the course. It's phenomenal. It's amazing. You won't be disappointed. So after your equipment, which in my case, again, $4,200, you're on the low end, you're still looking at about $1,000, because you have a microphone, you got a mixer, condenser, the mixing podcast, the podcast software that you're going to use to mix it and everything. Plus you have to learn, you know, how to do all that. And JOD goes into a little bit in a free podcast course, but in my opinion, not so much that you can just buy the, you know, software and be able to do it. So there's that. Then you're going to need your cover art. Again, and just because I got the entire Adobe Creative Suite, I have Photoshop. But if you don't have Photoshop, or you're just not, you know, artistically inclined, you can go on a site called Fiverr.com, or you can go on 99 Designs, and it costs you anywhere from, you know, $10 all the way up to $100. You're going to need a website. You're going to have to go to GoDaddy, and you're going to have hosting for your website. You're going to go to HostGator or Bluehost. Then you're going to need to host your audio files on a service like Libsyn or SoundCloud. And then if you plan on interviewing people for your podcast, you could probably do well with a scheduling software like a Schedule Once or SimplySchedule.me, something like that. And they range for about, you know, $15-$20 a month. So make no mistake, there are hard costs associated with producing content for free. And I wrestled with this for a long time, because going back to my CEO space horror story, where this person was wanting all this stuff for free but wasn't willing to pay the cost, I just kind of chalked that up to an old mindset, right? Because, you know, I read Rich Dad Poor Dad like everybody else. I like Robert Kiyosaki, but let's be frank, he's an old guy and he thinks like an old guy. And so I just thought that, you know, that mentality, that expectation was from a bygone era before we had officially entered the age of pay-to-play and social media. So I was really shocked when I was listening to the Social Pros podcast, and Jay Baer had Nick Cicero on there, who was the original co-host of the Social Pros podcast. He has since had Jeffrey K. Roars and now Adam Brown from Salesforce as his co-host. And Nick Cicero was like, he was surprised that not more people offered to work for free for him. And Jay Baer, you know, readily co-signed that sentiment. And it kind of caught me off guard, because, you know, like I said, I thought that this person, you know, and she wasn't old by any means. She was in her 40s. But I just thought that was old thinking before we had officially entered the age of pay-to-play in social media. And so I sent Nick Cicero and Jay Baer the same email, as a matter of fact, which neither of them responded to, because in hindsight, it did come across as a little terse. And I'll read that to you. I'll read to you what I sent to Jay Baer. And the title of the email was, "Pay to Play, But Still Work for Free." Salutations, Jay, because salutations is more fun than hello. I really enjoy your recent interview with Social Pros where you interviewed former host Nick Cicero. I was struck by a comment he made towards the end of the interview where he stated he was surprised more people don't offer to work for him for free, a sentiment you readily co-sign. I'm curious how you think that works in the age of pay-to-play digital media, and in particular social media. Seriously, I'm just asking. That's not meant to be accusatory or anything other than genuinely inquisitive. You see, I'm wrestling with this for many moons now, ever since first reading Rich Dad Poor Dad over a decade ago. On the one hand, I absolutely see the wisdom in working for free as articulated by Robert Kiyosaki and others. But on the other hand, as you yourself have given quite a bit of ink to, the social media free ride is over. We've officially entered the age of pay-to-play in social media and digital marketing as a whole. So how is it that you expect someone to work for free in a play-to-play in a pay-to-play space? I don't get how that works. Here's where things really snap in my head. Let's say I'm willing to work for free. However, that isn't my own labor, isn't my only cost of doing business. Whenever we run Facebook campaigns, we use a tool called Reach Rocket by Marty Warntraub of AimClear, who you should totally have on the Social Pros podcast, by the way. Hint, hint, wink, wink. Sure, it has a free option, but the functionality is limited compared to what you need to provide professional services. So even though I'm willing to put the time in at no cost, I still have a cost of doing business, bracket, Reach Rocket, which must be paid. And of course, Reach Rocket is in addition to the actual ad spend and other hard costs associated that must be paid for the campaign to run. Am I making sense here, Jay? Again, I'm genuinely trying to gain an understanding of how this work for free philosophy works in your head so I can make it work in mine, because it just doesn't at the moment, not given the current climate of digital marketing where it is. I'm a huge fan and hope that you take the time to respond. I've been an avid listener of your podcast for years now and really enjoy your work. Kind regards, Timmy. And as I previously said, Jay did not respond because Jay probably thinks I'm a hater just because of how I worded that email, which is regrettable. And I sent the same thing to Nick Cicero. Nick Cicero did not respond either. But while I did not have access to them, I do have access to Kerry O'Shea Gorgon, who is the host of the Social Pros podcast by Marketing Props, and actually how I became aware of Jay Baer in the first place. Because she was a Full Sail professor, I started listening to the podcast, and through her podcast, I got turned on to basically everybody else. I listen to like 10 podcasts now, not exaggerating, and they all originated from the Social Pros podcast. Putting me on to Jay Baer, Dory Clark, just Mark Schaefer, everybody, Matt Collier, it all has its roots with Kerry. So I reach out to Kerry, whining, and I'm like, Kerry, Jay think I'm a hater, he won't talk to me, he hates me, it's the end of the world. And so Kerry, nice lady that she is, she's like, well, I can't really talk for Jay, but I'm almost positive he wasn't talking about MarTech, which is marketing technology, the actual cost of the tools to use. So she referred me to the Marketing Profs, you know, forum area where you can ask questions. And I got a really good response that I'm going to read to you that had I had a year ago, could have saved me a lot of turmoil from the many mishaps that I shared in this episode. And here's a little script that I'll have in the show notes that you can use when working for free that won't put you in a bad position. So it says that I'm eager to show you what I can do and how valuable I can be to your business. In fact, I'm prepared to work for free for the first month or two because I know you want more once you see the value I can provide. All I ask is you cover out-of-pocket expenses and commit to a media budget of at least $500 a month billed directly to you by Google and or Facebook. Out-of-pocket expenses won't exceed $100 per month, guaranteed. Sound fair? I know you won't regret this. I'm eager to show you what I can do for your business. So that's a script that would have saved me a lot of turmoil in the CEO space debacle. And, you know, it works really well. I actually used that script on Marty Weintraub because we're friends on LinkedIn. He had a SEM position available at AimClear in Minneapolis. So I hit him and I was like, do you need to be in Minneapolis or is this a virtual position? And he was like, you need to be present in Minneapolis. And so I hit him with the script and he said, no. It didn't work that time, but overall, it's still pretty solid, still pretty sound. And me and Marty kind of bantered back and forth after that because I live in Atlanta, and he lives in the tundra of Minneapolis, Minnesota. And so we just kind of had a little fun with that afterwards. But yeah, I hope this podcast was helpful. I hope I was able to go into detail of why I structure my podcast the way that I do and how working for free, you can get put out, but you don't have to get put out. And hopefully, you know, really going into detail and giving you my experiences, both good and bad, on how to navigate those waters helps you do just that. But hopefully by now you understand why I do what I do and why I structure it the way I structure it. So, signing off, hope I helped all those young professionals out there, or just anybody in general, and I will see you next week. Have you ever been paralyzed while doing research? You go to Google, you type in your search query, and seconds later, you're hit with millions, if not billions, of search results, and you can't make heads or tails out of any of them. Overwhelmed and afraid you'll make the wrong choice, you don't make any choice at all. Well, friends, you're not alone, but you needn't suffer in silence. The ability to make sense out of what you find online, and more importantly, call BS when you see it, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as what I've learned getting a degree in internet marketing for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. One more time, bit.ly.com/DMD course. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.